Welcome back to the second and concluding part of our look at the solo. In this video, we'll look at the configuration section. To access the configuration pages, you'll need to be on the solo's local network. From a browser on the network, enter https://, and either the name of the solo or its IP address, followed by /config/. Note that the address begins with HTTPS and that there is a second /, after the word config, both of which are important. You may receive a security warning, in which case you can safely ignore it. Then enter the username and password, which by default are Solo and CloudWatcher. You now have a small menu of icons to the left, with the familiar message box to the right. The left-hand spanner icon takes us to the configuration page. The icons have changed, but the message area remains. The three buttons to the left allow for the current, previous, and default configurations to be loaded. The Load Current Configuration button acts as an undo function should you enter an incorrect value and forget the original one. The section in the middle allows the units to be selected as desired, and the green tick is used to confirm any changes made on the page. The red cross takes you back to the previous menu. If you are familiar with the CloudWatcher software, then you will immediately recognise many of the settings. Whereas the settings in the CloudWatcher software are accessed via tabs, most here are presented on a single page. Working from top to bottom, the Observatory section allows you to customise the title and subtitle that appear in the upper left of the solo's pages, and the time zone used for the display in the upper right of the screen. Altitude, latitude and longitude are also entered in this section and used in the calculation of various parameters. Incidentally, the latitude and longitude can be entered to the nearest degree. The Status Limit section contains similar information to the Limits tab in the CloudWatcher software. And to save time, I won't go into detail on the meaning of the various fields here, except to point out that if you have the optional atmospheric pressure and relative humidity sensor, then limits to the pressure thresholds are optional. The Switch and Limits section combines elements of the settings that would be found in the Setup and Limits tab of the CloudWatcher software. There is a checkbox to specify whether the hardware switch is used, and a further checkbox to determine the treatment of the unsafe condition. The Delay After Unsafe setting determines how long the software waits after conditions improve before changing the status back to safe. You may recall from the CloudWatcher video that I used the example of wind to explain this setting. By waiting 300 seconds or 5 minutes, as in the example, we can be sure that the wind speed really has dropped before changing the state to safe again. If you are familiar with the CloudWatcher software, then you will recall that we have to define limits on the Limits tab, and then tell the software which limits to regard as unsafe on the Unsafe tab. The Solo simplifies this process by always generating an unsafe condition when the condition goes beyond the limit specified here. If you don't want to receive an unsafe alert, simply set the value of the parameter to a level which can't be reached in the normal case. For example, I may choose not to receive an unsafe warning due to the atmospheric pressure. In this case, I can set the threshold to 700 hectopascals and be confident that this level will never be reached. The cloud detection delay time is a time interval imposed on the cloudy, unsafe condition to prevent a sequence aborting due to a small amount of cloud. Only if the cloud continues to be present after this delay will the status change to unsafe. In the next section, the K factors can be edited. The K factors are beyond the scope of this tutorial, and we plan to produce a separate video on the subject as we know it is of interest to many of our users. The Miscellaneous Temperature Settings section allows offsets to be entered to the ambient temperature and temperature derived from the IR sensor. At present, there is an option to select the source of ambient temperature from the drop-down menu. This option may have been removed by the time you watch this video. The final section, heater, allows the rain sensor's heater parameters to be adjusted. Again, this subject is beyond the scope of today's video. Let's go back to the main configuration menu by clicking the red cross icon. The cogwheel icon takes us to the settings menu. If you have upgraded your Solo from a previous version to firmware version 3, you'll probably be surprised to find that this section has grown quite significantly. The date and time settings can be manually set, and the change is confirmed with the Change Date and Time button. New in version 3, the System Name section now shows the serial number and firmware version of the CloudWatcher hardware. You can save time by including this information in any initial contact with our support service, as it's normally one of the first questions we will ask when trying to resolve a problem. As you can see, the current name of your Solo is displayed here and can be changed. I want to spend a moment to discuss the implications of this. Each Solo ships with the default name of AAG Solo, and this will usually work on most standard networks. Sometimes changing the name may cause you to lose contact with your device. If this happens, you can use the IP address of your Solo to establish contact on your local network. And this nicely brings us to the next section, Network Config. By default, the Solo will be set to use DHCP. And this should be enough to get you up and running. As soon as possible, we would recommend you to reconfigure your router to always allocate the same IP address to the Solo, as this greatly simplifies management of your network. We plan to make a video on general networking at a later stage, as this is a cause of many support queries. For now, if you have any questions, please post them to our forum or contact us via the customer support email address. The DNS config screen allows you to specify name servers. Here, I have entered my gateway as the primary DNS and the Google servers as backup. Your own settings will almost certainly be different. The next three sections have been added by demand and are somewhat specialist in nature. Android users can make use of the zeroconf tool to distribute the CloudWatcher data file across the internet. If you use push bullet or pushover, you can have the Solo send messages via these services when it changes the safe unsafe state. MQTT publishing allows users of message queuing telemetry transport to use this technology to publish the CloudWatcher data. The final three fields bring us back to more familiar territory. There is a field to change the standard password to one of your choice, a section to reboot the Solo, and lastly, a section to turn off the Solo completely. Unless you have a significant problem with the CloudWatcher, we don't advise you to fully shut down the Solo, as the only way to restart it in that case is to manually recycle the power supply. Returning to the main menu at the top of the screen, a useful feature of the Solo is the ability to add a USB storage device to one of the Solo's four USB ports, and to use this to store a record of the CloudWatcher's output. The Unmounted button allows you to unmount this storage device prior to removing it. We conclude our look at the Solo with the final section of the configuration menu, the Update button. Clicking here reveals two sections, Update and Version Control. The Update section allows you to check for and update to the latest software version. If you are still using version 2, you may be frustrated at being unable to update online to version 3. The reason for this is that version 3 was a major upgrade that included a new version of the Linux kernel. This requires the micro SD card in the Solo to be updated. There are full instructions on how to do this, both on the forum and on our website. And I'll just take the opportunity here to show you how to remove the top cover of the Solo to gain access to the SD card. Once you have updated the card, future updates can again be carried out online. Should you experience a problem with a software update, the version control section allows you to go back to a previous version. So far, we haven't discussed updating the CloudWatcher's firmware from the Solo. In fact, the easiest way to do this is via a PC or laptop. However, if this isn't practical, then there is a tutorial on our website which takes you through the steps required to update via the Solo. Once again, we plan to release a separate video on this subject. That concludes our detailed look at the Solo. As always, we hope you found this video useful. If you have any questions, please visit our forum or contact us via the support email address. Thank you for watching, and until next time, goodbye.